Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. We welcome you to this topic of today, which is on Russia. And the topic for today is transfer pricing legislation and practical approach to transfer pricing compliance in Russia. My name is Virendra Sharma, and I'm a partner with Transfer Pricing Associates in Amsterdam. I will be the moderator of this presentation today. And this presentation will be run by my colleague, Dimitri, who is a partner in Intra Pricing Solutions, which is a member firm of Transfer Pricing Associates. And as you are aware, Transfer Pricing Associates is a global firm which has operations in more than 60 countries, and we work through alliance members across the globe, and we work in full range of tax services, and we also advise clients on matters in finance like corporate finance, international finance. So before I give the floor to my colleague Dimitri, I would like to mention about certain house rules. If you have any question on any point in the presentation, you can send it by text by checking the box, chat box, and we will address those questions during two time during the presentation. One, when we have completed half of the slides. Second, at the end of the presentation. And after this presentation is finished, complete, then we will be saving the recorded version, and you can access this recorded version almost in a week's time if you would like to revisit this presentation. So I request my colleague Dimitri to take this presentation now. Thank you.
Thank you for introduction. As already mentioned, my name is Dmitry Sapchinsky. I'm a partner in the company Enterprising Solutions. Our company is specializing in transpricing advice and development and marketing of various software tools for transfer pricing. Since our presentation today about Russia and Russian TP legislation and practical approach, let's just focus on that. Somebody on the line still with microphone on, could you please shut it down? Because it's getting a bit distracted. Okay. Let's see. So, moving to the content, today we're going to talk about, I'll provide a quick overview of transfer pricing rules in Russia. Touch upon main differences between common practice and TP rules in Russia, which also important. Some attention points to TP compliance in Russia, and we'll also show some practical approach that could be taken by multinational to reduce the burden of transfer pricing compliance in Russia. All your TP rules in Russia, as you can see on the screen, the rules were introduced from January 2012 with some gaps of, let's say, turnover and amount of transactions. The main differences, the main things that were introduced in comparison to the older legislation is reduction of the list of transactions that can be controlled by Russian tax authorities. Because before it was a very long list, they could control almost anything. Now there is only specific transactions that fall under the transfer pricing rules. Then one of the most important points is abolishment of the 20% safe harbor. In the old transfer pricing legislation, there was so-called 20% hub rule. What does it mean that if your pricing on goods, services, or whatsoever in the transaction is within 20% let's say 20% more, 20% less than market price, and usually it was the price of commodities, then it was it used to be considered at arm's length. Now it's changed. It's now follow more or less rules as we know it in OECD guidelines, although it's not actually following them. One another important point that was introduced in this TP legislation that introduction of special transparency audits and penalties for non-compliance. What does it mean is that now the in Russia there is a special unit that has been created in tax authorities that can perform audits only on transfer pricing. And in penalties, I will show the table with penalties later on, that for non-compliance, for not having sufficient documentation to document your transfer pricing, the penalties have been introduced. One of the last points is introduction of EPAs for companies registered as the large taxpayers. What does mean in practice is that only companies which qualify as large taxpayers and there are special considerations to be taken can apply for EPA.
Dmitry, I have I have a quick question here. Now, as we know that the main changes were introduced from 1st January 2012. So yes. Is it right to say that the companies who are doing business in Russia, they have less risk for any transactions they had before January 12? Because before January 12, we did not have a very detailed guidance from Russia tax authorities.
I would say it's some kind of you can look at it two ways. The rules were not clear, and the judge in the case could take any route he wants on the application of transparency rules. So the only clear rule was 20% in safe harbor. You're probably aware of certain cases that happened before 2012, and some famous Russian politicians went to prison for that, like Yukos case and so on. Transpricing was used as a tool to target these companies. With introduction of the rules, although there is some compliance burden has increased for the companies, but if you look at it from practical view, it's now easier to operate because since rules now follow Western transparency rules, so the rules, the transparency policy multinationals applied in other regions, for example, in Europe, they can also apply them in Russia with some small considerations, and I will touch upon them a bit later.
Okay, so it's good, I think, now, but can we say that Russia now has bilateral APAs, so even if there are adjustments in Russia, the taxpayer can go for bilateral APAs also, right?
I don't know anybody who went for bilateral APAs because none of them have been negotiated yet. But I know that local APAs, like APAs that are only applicable in Russia when they negotiate only in Russia. There are already several cases the big taxpayer like Gazprom, Rosneft has conducted for simple transactions with the Russian tax authorities or they signed the agreement.
Okay, thank you.
Control transactions. Has been introduced that certain type of the transactions has to be documented and comply with transparency regulations. That would be all cross-border transactions with related parties, irrespective of the amount of the transaction, meaning that if you even sell one box filled with pencils, you need to document. You need to have documentation to prove that the pricing you apply is at arm's length or market price, and you need to also submit certain forms to tax authorities by the end of the year to inform tax authorities about this transaction. One thing which should be also taking into consideration is, you can see bullet point number two, is cross-border transactions with non-related parties. This is also kind of a Russian-specific thing, that transactions with low tax jurisdictions or on sales on commodities, even if you sell them to non-related parties, and the amount exceeds 60 million rubles, or it's approximately where it used to be 1.1 million euro. I think now it's almost 2 million euro. If it exceeds this amount, you have to document the transaction as well, because a lot of, especially commodity transactions take place between Russia and low tax jurisdictions like Switzerland or Cyprus or even some tax havens like Seychelles and BVI. Another important point with Russian trans pricing legislation, and it also touches upon foreign multinationals, is that you also have to document transactions within Russia. Meaning, if, for example, you have an entity in Moscow and another entity in St. Petersburg, and there are some transactions between them, for example, service transactions or sale of goods, and it exceeds 20 million euro, you have to document it as well, and you have to prepare trans pricing documentation. This is more like this is the same approach that has been taking, for example, in the U.S. interstate trans pricing, or you know, like in other countries in Europe, like in Spain, for example. You also have to sometimes document transactions between the different regions of the country.
And Dmitry, on your point about domestic transactions, my experience has been that there are certain countries where domestic transactions are covered under trans pricing regulation. However, when the TP audit takes place, the tax authorities are not, they do not pursue or they do not follow up the domestic transactions so aggressively as they do for cross-border transactions. So what is your experience in Russia about these domestic transactions?
As you can see, the amount of transactions set quite high, let's say reasonably high for 20 million euro. You have to take into consideration that as you can see, it's introduced in 2014 onwards, meaning last year and this year. So last year is still being documented. The documentation needs to be prepared, and special filings need to be filed before May 20. So 2014 is not closed yet. So therefore, we don't know yet how the tax authorities are going to react and how they're going to audit. So it's taxpayers are just preparing this documentation. So for multinationals who operate inside Russia and have internal transactions, we strongly recommend to have it, because it's just required by law. You not to have not only the documentation, but also to file the form. How it's going to be audited, nobody knows yet, because it's just as you can see, we're still expecting it.
And
audit we'll see after the summer, basically. It's the same. Another thing which was introduced is a definition of a related party. You can see on the screen, so I'm not going to read it through. You can read it yourself. What is a related party? It's a bit more clear definition than it used to be before. However, there is still room for interpretation. For example, a related party could be considered even your friend who you went to college with. Okay. In court of law, they can consider that you are related because you may influence decision of one another. But as you can see on the screen, that was written in the law. The threshold is 25% ownership threshold. In all the legislation, it was 20%, so it was a bit increased. And as I mentioned about courts, yeah, that's Russia, so you can't expect anything.
So, Dmitry, on this point of direct or indirect Russian state ownership,
yeah,
shall not by default lead to reason for treating the companies as related. So, are we saying that the all those companies where they have ownership by states, they would not be classified as related party?
Yes, for example, if you have ownership of state of more than 25% in the company. For example, you have company A, which owned by the state by 25%, and you have company B, which owned by state 25%. The transaction between them will not be classified automatically as related, because state itself is not considered to be as a related party.
Okay.
This point was added to protect companies like Gazprom, Rosneft, and all other Russian oil companies where state have some shareholdings from extensive burden. My difference is, of course, there is the difference, as you can see in point number one, in the hierarchy of information sources. In Russia, domestic sources always goes first and against foreign. And actually, with domestic sources, in 80% of the cases, you can document transactions, unless the transactions about commodity. But for example, if you have transactions on sales of goods, there is enough information on Russian companies to provide you with operating margin by applying TNMM, for example. Another important point is that application, for example, of process split method is very unlikely in Russia. If this method could be applied only if any other methods cannot be applied. So far, I've seen it maybe only a couple of times when company risked to apply profit split method, but they always suggest to the companies, you can't do that, but then try to do it with in combination with other. For example, if you apply profit split method on sales of some kind of commodity, also perform a benchmark study of local entity and make sure that the profitability of the entity still within the range of the certain population of companies. In that sense, you protect yourself from both sides.
And Dmitry, one point I have is that, you know, I have experienced that in certain countries which are, you know, emerging economies, there it is very difficult to find comparables because a lot of multinational enterprises, you know, subsidiaries in those emerging markets, they are not very complex companies. And if we have to look for comparables, then the comparables should be those comparables who should not have any related party transactions. So all those local comparables are doing different functions. They are some of them are doing full-fledged functions, so difficult to get comparables. But when you're in Europe or say in US, there still you get a lot of comparables because there are a lot of European headquartered companies, you know, which you can compare. So what's your experience in Russia? When you have to do a comparability analysis, do you get sufficient level of comparables to draw a comparison?
Of course, there are exceptions. For example, coming back to companies like commodities or mining and so on, it's difficult to get a comparable because these industries are very integrated, so there is almost no independent parties in this sector. But for standard transactions, there is a lot of comparables. And as I will touch upon in the last point when I will present practical solutions, our company is marketing and licensing software in Russia to create the Russian-specific documentation, which includes the database with already comparable companies. Hundreds of companies are using it, and it's well, the documentation created and benchmarking performed by this software was already audited and reviewed by tax authorities, and there is no questions about that. So to answer your questions, yes, there are enough, there's sufficient comparable companies in Russia to perform analysis, let's say, in 80% of the cases. The other 20s, if you're talking about commodities trading, mining, and other heavy industries, which are highly integrated, then, like everywhere in the world, you can't find comparables, and you have to try to find other methods, try to use other methods to prove that your pricing is correct.
But in that case, which method is used in Russia? Is it cup method or TNMM method? Do we see using by tax authorities most of the time?
Most of the times it's TNMM is applied, because information, financial information of Russian companies is basically as written in the law, you can use only operating margin data of the company, because that's the only reliable data available for Russian companies. Therefore, again, coming back to majority of usage, it's in most of the cases it's TNMM, which is applied. Sorry, I think I jumped to some slides, which is
helpful. Okay, thanks.
Another important point that you company from self-determined adjustments to increase profit of Russian entity, but you cannot do it other way around. For example, if you close the year and you, by the end of the year, you realized that your Russian subsidy is have too much profits, or the profit of Russian subsidies outside of the range, and you would like to decrease it, you cannot do it. But if it's your Russian subsidiary has for below the range, you can always adjust it upwards. Basically, you can always do adjustment only upwards, but not downwards for taxable profit in Russian entity, which is one-sided, but that's how it's written in the law. More specific on documentation requirements, starting from last year, penalty, as you can see, could be applied for non-compliance of 20%. All transactions need to be documented, and transactions within Russia with more than 1 billion rubles or 20 million euro. That's a threshold. Penalties in 2017 would be increased to 40%. So that's, again, that's how it's written in the law. So now we are working in first row. Most of our clients right now is documented to 2014, and next 2 years the penalty is 20%.
So Dmitry, when you say penalties, are these penalties are on the tax adjustment, or are these penalties for non-maintenance of documentation?
It could be combined. If, for example, if you don't have documentation or don't have compliant the documentation, tax authorities can use their own method of establishing arm's length pricing, and then they will adjust your profits of your company to the way they want. So first strike is if you don't have documentation. Second, if you based on assessment of tax authorities, they can assess that you haven't paid a certain amount of taxes, and on that you'll be on this transaction, 20% is a penalty. For example, if you have a transaction of 100, then you have to pay 20.
That's a very big, it's a big penalty. So 20% of the value of the international transactions, right?
Yes.
Okay.
TP documentation required. Basically, transparency documentation that is required is not so much different than in many other countries around the world. The transparency document has to provide an overview of the group, company, industry, financial analysis of each type of intra-company transaction. By meaning financial analysis, by mentioning financial analysis, it's meant, for example, if you supply one container of goods And in this container, you have, I don't know, pencils, pen, paper, and so on. Each type of this goods, if it's specified under different custom code, it has to be documented separate, a separate transaction. So that's basically you have to keep in mind. And another thing which need to be another thing that transparent documents need to be included is benchmarking, of course. And that's, as I already mentioned, Russian databases are preferred unless transaction tested party in the transaction is outside of Russia. For example, if you have headquarter services, then of course you would need to use foreign databases like Orbis, Osiris, or whatever. It is acceptable because Russian tax authorities understand that if services are provided from Europe or from US, then the databases of these countries need to be used.
And Dmitry, one point I have on this price setting mechanism. Now, there are certain countries where the TP regulation expects the taxpayer to have price setting done before or at the time of transaction is being entered into, and they expect the taxpayer to have a real-time pricing, which means maintaining a contemporaneous documentation as and when the transaction is happening. So what is your view on Russia? Is the taxpayer okay if he does price testing, price checking after the transaction is done, or that has to happen before transaction happens?
You have to understand that transfer pricing compliance is quite new in Russia. And what we see on the market is that most of the companies, of course, do price setting and price checking based on economic analysis or transfer pricing rules only after the transaction takes place. Or actually, we see some of our clients who had transactions in 2014 only now thinking how they're going to document. We and all other advisors are trying slowly to change the mentality, and the companies that actually have to prepare transferring documentation and establish, market price before transaction take place. It's not written in the law. Therefore, a lot of companies still just look at transfer pricing as compliance rather than way to manage your business. Most of the time we see that they do documentation after transactions have been done. So now we're doing documentation for the companies that have transactions in 2014.
So the law doesn't require taxpayer to maintain documentation, before the filing of tax return.
No, absolutely not. The law requires to have documentation. For example, if we're talking about year 2014. The transfer pricing documentation need to be ready before May of this year. So we have another three and a half months to go. And by May 20, as you can see on the screen, all documentation need to be prepared and special filing need to be done. As you can see in second bullet point, TP filing forms, and that is the most, this work requires the most work because this TP filing forms is some companies have tens of thousands pages that need to be prepared to be filed. It's really big work. We also create automated solution, but if you do it manually, it's as you can see here on the screen, each transaction has the document for each transaction has three pages. That have to mention method applied, amount received on the transactions, amount paid on the transactions, so a lot of information need to be included. So the first point, transfer pricing documentation itself, it's no different from the documents we prepare here in Europe or in the United States or in Asia, but TP filing forms, it's really different and it's really big work. And that's why, coming back to your question, when does the company do the compliance? They always do it after transaction take place. Usually, they do first filing forms, and then they prepare transfer pricing documentation.
Okay.
Next slide. Attention points. on TP compliance in Russia. One of the most common attention points is headquarter charges. And this attention point, it doesn't relate so much to the transfer pricing itself, but rather to the, let me rephrase that. It doesn't relate to transfer pricing compliance as it's written in transfer pricing law, but it relates to the compliance as it's written in accounting compliance in Russia. What does it mean? For example, you received headquarter services from your headquarter company, and you would like to pay for the services in accordance to the invoices and so on. These charges may be rejected by in Russian in tax audits, because if you would not be able to provide enough evidence that the services actually were provided, and that evidence could include amounts of work spent by people at headquarters for the benefit of Russia, exactly what has been delivered, and so on. So basically, a big audit trail, including plane tickets, minutes of the meetings, and so on, that were conducted for the benefits of Russia. And then Russian NGOs have to prove that these services really were beneficial. So we've been in the last 2-3 years, we have a lot of discussions with Russian tax authorities regarding it. Some of our clients had audits, and the headquarters charges were rejected, not because of the transfer pricing in compliance, because they had a perfect transfer pricing document prepared, justifying the, let's say, markup applied on headquarters services. They had they filed the transfer pricing forms, but they couldn't provide other evidence that the services were actually provided, received, and the charges were rejected.
Dmitry, when we now these headquarters charges, this has been a kind of a burning issue in many countries in Asia. That's what I experienced previously, and I've seen that tax authorities in those countries, they expect taxpayer to show that there was a need of services, and then yes, benefit test is very important. And I've also seen occasions where tax authorities, they expect the taxpayer to demonstrate that there has been some kind of, you know, cost savings by using head office services, or head office services help the taxpayer in increasing sales in the domestic market. And I've also seen that the tax authorities, they also expect a full detailed calculation of allocation, how the cost was allocated to the taxpayer, what allocation was used by the taxpayer and the group. So what is your experience on these two areas? One is the evidencing the benefits in terms of savings of cost or increasing sales, and expecting detailed allocation sheet by the tax authorities.
Exactly what you just mentioned. What you just mentioned that's happening in Asia, they expect in Russia. At least that's what was based on practice we have. Everything you mentioned, benefit test, detailed allocation calculation, detailed on actually savings of cost using headquarters services rather than acquiring services locally. All this needs to be documented and put in file before the tax audit. Otherwise, there is a chance that this service charges will be rejected.
Okay.
Other services basically the same. It's headquarters or other services the same approach. On intellectual property, one important point in Russia, any intellectual property charges, any royalty charges you would like to get from your Russian subsidiary, for example, for the use of your brand name or your some technical royalties, for example, for the use of recipes or whatsoever, you can do it only if this intellectual property is registered in Russia. Meaning, for example, if your trade name is not registered in Russia, you cannot charge any royalties for that. The same goes for recipes or for technical details. It need to be registered. There is a special organization in Russia which provides registration of patents, registration of trade names and trademarks before you do that. And I'm sure if you have companies operating in Russia, you already heard it from your local financial directors that they will not make any payments on for intellectual property before you do this registration.
And Dmitry, do we also have a situation where a taxpayer is challenged for their intercompany financing, where the taxpayer in Russia has taken loan from a group company, and the tax authorities, they expect right arm's length interest, and also do we have any thin capitalization rules in Russia?
Regarding financial transactions, at the first instance, they are included in the law, of course, but only from this year the financial transactions need to be documented. There is thin capitalization rules, of course, like everywhere else. From the top of my head, I can also tell you the percentages of the rules, how they are applied, but they are there. And financial transactions, like everywhere in the world, you need to prove that this loan or guarantee has been provided, that what is the arm's length interest rate, it all has to be documented. But it wasn't the point of attention yet. You see on the screen, I didn't mention that because there hasn't been too many cases regarding the financial transactions yet. But we are expecting them to come probably at the end of this year.
Okay. Okay. Thanks, Dmitry. And now we can just pause for a short while because we can ask audience if they have any questions now so far on these slides. So if anyone has any question, they can put the question in chat box, and then we can answer those questions. So I repeat, if anyone in the audience has any question, they can type their question in chat box, and we can then answer that question. Dmitry, there is one question is on this deemed transaction. Now, when we look at deemed transactions, these are those transactions where the two companies are not related party, but because two third parties, they were doing business, and then because of the relationship, they created this deeming transaction or deemed transaction. So what's your experience in Russia? Many instances where tax authorities, they claim that two third parties are actually behaving like related parties cross border?
There have been a couple of cases like that in the last year where the transactions were deemed related, although the direct party were in related, but through the obtaining information from offshore company, I think it was company in Cyprus, they proved that the companies actually related. And it was treated as a transaction, and certain fines were applied to the company.
Okay, thanks. And the second question is, do you think whether unilateral APA is advisable for the Russian taxpayer? Because there are less examples for bilateral APA, so should the taxpayer go for the unilateral APA in Russia to get certainty?
I would say unless it says you have very, very difficult transaction, I would say no, because it's very lengthy process, first of all. Secondly, it requires a certain amount of payment upfront. Actually, you pay to get an APA to Russian tax authorities. And secondly, by it lengthy because the tax authorities would require a lot of information, not only on your local transactions, but also for transactions outside of the country. So in my experience, even APAs that were signed in Russia right now is APAs for very simple service transactions within some oil companies. It's, so I would say don't do it because first of all, there is no there is a big chance you will not get an APA, but you will open too much information, unnecessary information to Russian tax authorities.
I have another question from the audience, Dimitri. This question I'll read for you. If we are able to show that there are no local comparables available, then from a practical standpoint, does the Russian tax authority accept comparables from other countries, which is, I think, foreign comparables?
You can do that. As I mentioned, there is a hierarchy of usage of information. If you can prove that there is nothing in Russia comparable, you can use foreign comparables. But again, I should stress that even if you use foreign comparables, we always advise to the client still use try to find relatively comparable, functionally comparable companies in Russia, just to double check that your company operating in Russia follows, let's say, the profitability of the companies. But yeah, to answer the question, you can use foreign comparables in the absence of Russian ones.
Okay. And then I'll go to the next question from the audience, which is when a royalty is charged to a Russian distribution company and calculated as a percentage of third-party sales, are there any custom issues when the distribution company buys the products from a related party company overseas?
You have to really separate transfer pricing and customs in Russia, because customs rules in Russia is different than let's say it's not the price you put on your invoice. You get taxed on, or you pay custom duties. But tax authorities have a catalog of goods, on each number there is a certain amount of customs has to be paid. Again, I'm not a custom expert. I cannot really answer that question, but it's it does not relate to transfer pricing.
I think I agree with you, Dimitri, but my experience sometimes has been that what position we take on transfer pricing, it can also have impact from customs. So do you think the custom authority and transfer pricing authority in Russia, they talk to each other? Do they exchange information with each other? Is that the case in Russia?
That's absolutely correct. They talk to each other, and they will exchange information because, as you saw in the documents you need to supply to tax authorities, it's very detailed documents on sales of goods and pricing you apply. All this information is collected now and analyzed. The same happens with custom data. So at certain point, I don't know if it's done already or it will be done in the next year or so, this information will be really linked to each other, and I'm sure tax authorities would easily pinpoint the transactions that don't match.
Okay. The next question is if there is a TP adjustment made by increasing the taxable profit of the Russian company, have you seen cases where tax authorities would challenge the taxpayer on import and or VAT side?
On VAT side, definitely yes, because it will relate to the pricing applied. On import or say on customs, it's not. As I said, it's two different things for now. But if you will get adjustment on pricing on certain goods, you will be get adjustment on VAT. And VAT is very important point in Russia because you always pay it. Then maybe one day you can claim it back.
Okay, thanks. And the next question is, what databases does the Russian tax authority use for conducting comparables and agreement search?
They use Spark. It's kind of the database similar to Amadeus, for example, but Russian specific. Our software is also linked to Spark database. It's so Spark from Interfax is the main database they use for company analysis. And there are other databases also from Interfax, the database provider that are used for financial transactions, for example, bonds or information on for example, transactions related to loans or guarantees. You can easily analyze using Spark database because they have enough data. They analyze profitability of the banks, and based on this data, they can calculate the arm's length market interest rates or market guarantee fee.
Thanks, Dmitry. And the last question is with respect to this BAPS, the documents which we will expect from BAPS action plan. I think like country by country reporting, and then setting up the TP documentation in Russia, which all documents need to be translated into Russian language, for example, master file or forms, what all documents need to be translated into Russian language?
I would say based on the law, as I mentioned here in the previous slides, as you can see, first bullet point, first part need to be translated, but only related to the Russian transactions. You actually have to create a translation document that compliance in Russia. Any other BEPS related things is not put in the law yet in Russia, so you don't need to open up your master files or any other transactions that need to be documented and as described in BEPS.
Okay, thanks, Dmitry. Now you can continue with your remaining slides.
Okay. Practical approach. As I mentioned before, our company is developing transfer pricing tools, and one of those tools is a leader in Russia now. What this tool does is helping companies to comply with the Russian transfer pricing requirements. You can see our software, global software called TP Genie, but in Russia, this our software called Spark CP and Astra. What it does is you can easily create documentation consistent with your global TP policy, but in Russian language. The software also integrates a special tool for creating the tax filing forms, which you do is you download from your ERP system all financial data needed for this form. Injected in the software or uploaded in the software, and our software creates filing forms that is filed to tax authorities. It's easy to maintain and update. Basically, what our software allows taxpayers to do: create documentation once, and just every year with few clicks of the buttons, update benchmarking studies and so on. And it's transparent not only to Russian management, but also my management of on global level. What's happening right now, for example, local subsidiaries usually go to their local auditors and they create them transfer pricing documents just for compliance purposes. And quite often this document doesn't match global transfer pricing policy. We see it quite often with our clients. The software allows for synchronization of transfer pricing policy, meaning that you control the risk that the global policy you actually apply is reflected in the local transfer pricing documentation. How does it work? I will not bore you with show of the software because it's not part of this presentation, but as an infographic you can see here what's happening. On step one, a taxpayer identify all intercompany transactions that need to be documented under transfer pricing regulation. Software allows for easy functional and risk analysis with easy help text which is filled out by taxpayer based on what's the global master file information or just information that they have at hand. Software can also do automatic transpricing method selection. It can be done either automatically based on the information you filled in the first 2 points, or based on the you can do it manually if you think other method is more appropriate. Benchmarking study. What's happening there? Our software for Russian market is linked to the database. What we've done, we've done it in partnership with Interfax, the leading database provider of Russia. It's kind of top Reuters of Russia. What we've done with them is that we took all the data, we cleaned it up, meaning we cleaned all the companies, and only comparable companies or companies that can be used as comparable, meaning independent companies, are put in the database. By selecting certain functions that is performed by your subsidiary, software automatically can create benchmarking study for you. As you can see, it's links here to the database. As a next step, you review the information that has been filled out. If you agree with the transfer writing method that has been selected for you by software, you can create a transpricing documentation. It's basically quite easy to do, and it's a straightforward approach. And as practice shows, it's easy to use because people in Russia or financial directors in Russia who is responsible for compliance with transfer pricing, who doesn't have usually transfer pricing experience or knowledge, and by using this software can easily comply with TPD regulations in Russia. Last step is using the data from ERP system for creating this special filing form for submission of tax authorities. Some of our clients, global clients, use our global tool using global tool, which works the same way. They prepare master file, and then with few clicks, they can create the local files, and not only actually in Russia, but everywhere else in the world with special formats, and sometimes even with language adjusted. But that, again, it's not part of this presentation. I'm just here to try to explain how practically you can approach your compliance. If you do it in orderly manner, it's not that difficult. If you don't do it, let's say, in advance, it might create quite a big burden for the Russian subsidiary. And we'll have any more slides? Let me see. Yeah, that's it, I think. Yeah. So I guess now we'll go to the questions.
And, yeah, thanks, Dmitry. So to audience, if you have any question, please write your question in chat box and so that we can see it and answer to your question. So Dmitry, meanwhile we receive questions from the audience. I have one general question that now we know that we have so many action plans are out by OECD under BAPS project, and some of them are related to transfer pricing, and they're going to change, you know, the way international tax has been looked at over the last couple of years. So what is your experience, how the Russian tax authorities are responding to BEPS action plan project, and do you see that it will have some impacts in Russia? For example, country by country reporting has to be in place for fiscal year ending in the year 2016, and then from that date there will be 12 months by which MNE or multinational group has to comply with C by C reporting. So what's your experience from Russian tax authorities perspective?
Just basically one thing is important to know about Russia. Russia and Russian tax authorities work by law, meaning that now they have this law, there will be this law does not touch anything about BEPS or country by country reporting. There are discussions, of course, already in the Ministry of Finance by making adjustments to the law that would maybe follow the some points mentioned in BEPS. But before it's published, it's difficult to say how they will respond to that. Even this trans pricing regulations, which was published in 2011 and started applicable from 2012, took almost 6 years to prepare. And at the end of the day, when it was published, it was still published with, let's say, mistakes and inconsistencies. So I would say if everywhere in the world it will the BEPS compliance or country by country compliance will be implemented from 2016. In Russia, probably it will be implemented a couple of years later.
Okay, and what's your experience on mutual agreement procedures? Like whenever any adjustment happened to taxpayer in Russia, and because of double taxation, the Russian taxpayer would go to competent authority. So, do you think Russian competent authority they have good connect with competent authorities in other countries to resolve trespassing disputes?
They do have let's say they have been cases when this has been resolved, because of course Russia has the double tax treaties, and and this treaty network is used by taxpayers and tax authorities. But it's a lengthy process. It's not easy. It's not the direct line. So it's not easy to do. It's really costly. It's only companies with really big adjustments would go for it.
Okay. I have one question from the audience, which is, I'll read for you, Dmitry. This is, what about language translation, as MNEs have either core documents always in English and want to use as much as copy-paste as possible? And the audience says, I assume the formats of the TP documentation follows local rules and not standard international ones. I think the key question here is that if some part of the MNE's documentation has to be leveraged for preparing local Russian documentation, does that need to be translated into local language?
Definitely yes. The documentation that is need to be supplied in Russia is should be only in Russian. The easy way to do it, also say to, that's why we have this portion of presentation practical approach. By using, for example, our trans-pricing gene tool, you can easily do that, because especially for Russian part, if you have if you fill it out in English, it will spit out the document in Russian language as well. So it's there are ways to do it, but other ways you can just take relevant part of your master file manually, comply Russian specific document which includes points which I mentioned previously here.
Okay.
Bullet point, and hire somebody to translate it for you. You can do that, but it's you have to be very careful, because the references need to be correct, methods need to be selected and described appropriate, like it's supposed to be described in Russian translation documentation.
Okay. The next question I have is the question reads like this: again, on upwards TP adjustment, the Russian tax code does not provide for any requirements for taxpayers to restore the originally offset VAT amounts to the Russian budget in case of transfer pricing adjustment of corporate profits tax obligations. So in that case, have you experienced the Russian tax authorities to attempt to challenge reduction of excessively paid VAT, as the purchase price of goods should have been lower formally, like Dell Russia should have offset less import on value added tax? Maybe I think the audience is mentioning some case law here.
I didn't get the question correctly. So basically the question is, can you offset VAT against excessive profits? Basically, I'm not a tax lawyer, so I will just answer based on knowledge I have, but don't take it for granted. As far as I know, VAT paid can be offset against excess profit, because I know some of our clients have done that. For example, they pay VAT they could offset this against the profits.
Dimitri, I think the question here is that if suppose the price of goods was say $100, yeah, and then on that VAT was paid, but mm-hmm, after adjustment it was found that the purchase price should have been lower. Mm-hmm. So in the deduction, the VAT which is claimed at deduction is higher because the purchase price has brought down by the tax authorities. So mm-hmm, the question is that will taxpayer will get full deduction of the VAT although the price of goods has come down?
No, first of all, as you see now on the screen, the last point, we're talking about adjustment again. If it's adjusted downwards, you cannot do it. But if you adjust upwards, you have to adjust your VAT as well, and that you can do.
Okay, yeah. Okay. So we have covered all questions, Dimitri, and now we are closing the session. Okay, we would like to thank you for your valuable inputs, and thanks for audience also for their patient participation. If you still have any questions, you can send your question by email to us. The contact details are available on the last slide, but you can also visit our website. And as I mentioned earlier, the recorded version of this webinar will be available in a week's time. So if you would like to revisit this webinar, so you can do it in a week's time. And we look forward to have more webinars in the future. So look forward to inviting you on another seminars. And thank you very much again. And thanks, Dimitri, for your time.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.